was Saturday. Seemed like the whole county was coming for Tom Robinson's trial. And where are you going?
To the chitney jungle.
In a hat and gloves?
I might just stop by the courthouse and see what Atticus is up to.
Careful he doesn't hand you a subpoena. You seem to know so much about the case. When I reached the courthouse, it was covered in picnic parties. Apparently, the trial was to be a gala occasion. There was no room at the public kitchen rail. Mules and wagons were parked under every available tree. People were washing down biscuits and syrup with warm milk from fruit jars. In the far corner of the square, Negro sat in the sun, very quiet. At some invisible signal, they all got up and started into the courthouse.
We're too late. There's no seats.
Let's go sit with Reverend Sykes.
In your own words, Mr. Tate.
Well, I was called by...
Could you say it to the jury, Mr. Tate? Who called you?
I was fetched by Bob, Mr. Yule, yonder, one night.
What night, sir?
November the 21st. I was leaving the office to head home when Bob, Mr. Yule, came in. Pretty excited he was, and said, get to his house quick. Some Negro had raped his girl.
And did you go?
Certainly. Jumped in the car, went out as fast as I could.
And what did you find?
Found her lying on the ground. She was mighty banged up. I heaved her to her feet. She washed her face in the bucket, and she said she was all right.
Go on.
I asked her who had hurt her like that, and she said it was Tom Robinson. Asked her if he had beat her up like that, and she said, yes, he did. I said, did he take advantage of you? And she said, yes, he had. So I went to the Robinson's house, brought him in. She identified him as the one, and I took him in. That's all there was to it.
Thank you.
Any questions, Atticus?
Yes. Did you call a doctor, Sheriff?
No, sir.
Why not?
Wasn't no need to. She was mighty banged up, though.
And you didn't think she needed...
He answered the question, Atticus. He didn't call a doctor.
Just making sure, Judge. Sheriff, you said she was mighty banged up. In what way? Just describe her injuries, heck.
Well, she had bruises coming on her arms, and she had a black eye starting.
Which eye?
Her left eye.
Now, her left facing you or her left looking the same way you were looking?
Her right eye. Mr. Finch, I remember now. That would make it her right eye. She was mighty banged up on that side of her face.
Please repeat what you said.
Her right eye.
No, she said you said she was mighty banged up on that side of her face. Which side?
The right side.
Thank you, Heck.
Robert Yule.
Stand, please. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
So help me God.
Mr. Robert Yule.
That's my name, Captain.
Are you the father, Mayella Yule?
Well, if I ain't, I can't do anything about it now. Her ma's dead.
Are you the father of Mayella Yule?
Yes, sir.
Get this straight. There will be no audibly obscene speculations on any subject from anybody in this courtroom. Do you understand? Proceed, Mr. Gilmer.
Thank you. Mr. Yule, tell us what happened on the evening of November 21st.
I was coming in from the woods with low kindling, and just as I got to the fence, I heard Mayella screaming like a stuck hog inside the house.
What time was it, Mr. Yule?
Just before sundown. Mayella was in there squalling, so I ran in the house.
Then what did you do?
Run around the house to get in, but He run out the front door just ahead of me. Saw who he was, but too distracted about Mayel to run after him. Mayel was in there squalling, so I run the house.
Then what happened?
Run for heck take quick as I could. Saw who it was, all right. Passed the house every day. Lived down yonder in that nigger nest. Judge, I've asked this county for 15 years to clean out that nest down yonder. They're dangerous to live around. Besides,
that's all. Thank you, Mr. Yule.
Sir, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Yule. Folks were doing a lot of running tonight. Let's see. You say you ran to the fence. You ran to the house. You ran inside.
You ran for Mr. Tate. Did you, during all that running, run for a doctor?
Well, no need to.
You didn't think the nature of your daughter's injuries warranted immediate medical attention.
Never called a doctor in my life. If I had, it would cost me $5. That all the questions?
Not exactly. You heard the sheriff's testimony, didn't you?
Yes.
Do you agree with everything he said? That her right eye was blackened? That she was beaten around the...
Yeah, I hold with everything Tate said.
He said her right eye was blackened.
And I holds with Tate.
Mr. Yule, can you read and write?
Objection. Can't see what the witness's literacy has to do with the case. Irrelevant and immaterial.
Judge, if you'll allow the question, plus another one, you'll soon see.
All right, Atticus, but make sure we see. Overruled.
Will you write your name and show us?
I most positively will. How do you think I saw my relief check?
Jim, do you think Atticus knows what he's doing?
Seems like he knows.
Far back as I can remember, he said, never, never, never ask a question on cross-examination lest you already know the answer.
Because you might get an answer that'll wreck your case.
Looks to me he's gone frog sticking with that a lot.
Will you not write your name clearly so the jury can see you do it?
What's so interesting?
He's left-handed.
That's it.
What's my being left-handed have to do with it? He's trying to take advantage of me, tricking lawyers like Atticus Finch take advantage of me all the time with their tricking ways. They don't change what I saw. Now say it again. I saw
that's
that.
That's all, Mr. Yule. Yeah, let's get going.
Mayella Violet Yule. What were you doing on that evening?
I was on the porch.
And what were you doing on the porch?
Just tell us what happened. You can do that, can't you? What are you so scared of? What was that?
Him! Don't want him doing me like he done Papa, making him out left-handed.
How old are you?
19 and a half.
I see. Well, Mr. Finch has no idea of scaring you, and if he did, I'm here to stop him. Now, go back, sit up straight, and tell us what happened.
Well, I was on the porch, you see, and he come by. Papa had brought him this old shift robe to chop up for kindling. Papa told me to do it while he was off in the woods, but I wasn't feeling strong enough then. So he come by.
Who is he?
That and yonder, Robinson.
Then what happened?
Well, I said, come here, boy, and bust up this shift robe for me. I got a nickel for you. So he came in the yard, and I went in the house to get him the nickel. Next thing I knew, he was on me. He caught me around the neck. I fought, but he hit me again and again.
Go on.
And he took advantage of me.
Did you scream and fight back?
I kicked and hollered loud as I could.
Then what happened?
Well, don't remember too good. Pop had come in the house and was hollering, "Who done it?" Then I sort of fainted. Next thing I knew, Mr. Tate was helping me over to the water bucket.
You fought Robinson hard as you could, tooth and nail?
I certainly did.
And you are certain he took full advantage of you?
I told you, he done what he was after.
That's all the questions. But stay here. I expect Big Bad Mr. Finch has some questions.
State will not prejudice the witness against counsel for the defense.
Miss Mayella, I won't try and scare you. Not for a while. Not yet. Let's get acquainted. How old are you?
Said I was 19. I said it to the judge yonder.
You'll have to bear with me, Miss Mayella. I don't remember things as well as I used to, and I might ask you a question you've already said before, but you'll give me an answer, won't you? Good.
Won't answer a word as long as you keep on mocking me.
Ma'am.
Saying ma'am and calling me Miss Mayella? I don't have to take his sass.
That's just Mr. Finch's way. Now, we've done business in this court for years, and he's always courteous. Atticus, let's get on and let the record show the witness has not been sassed.
How many brothers and sisters do you have?
7.
You're the oldest?
Yes.
How long has your mother been dead?
Don't know. A long time.
How long did you go to school?
2 years, 3 years. Don't know.
Miss Mayella, a 19-year-old girl like you must have friends. Who are your friends?
Friends.
Don't you know anyone near your age? Boys, girls, just ordinary friends.
You making fun of me again, Mr. Finch?
Do you love your father, Miss Mayella?
I love him? What you mean?
Is he good to you? Is he easy to get along with?
He does tolerable, except when...
Except when...
I said he does tolerable.
Except when he's drinking. When he's riled. Has he ever beaten you?
Answer the question, Miss Mayella.
My pa's never touched a hair on my head.
We've had a good talk, Miss Mayella. Now we better get on to the case. You say you asked Tom Robinson to bust up a... What was it?
Shift robe. Old dresser.
Were you well acquainted with Tom Robinson?
What do you mean?
Did you know who he was? Where he lived?
I knowed who he was. He passed by the house every day.
Was this the first time you ever asked him to come inside the fence? Was this the first?
Yes, it was.
You never asked him to come inside the fence before?
I did not. I certainly did not.
You never asked him to do odd jobs for you before?
I might have. There were several niggles around.
Can you remember any other occasion?
No.
All right. Now to what happened. You say Tom Robinson caught you around the neck, is that right?
Yes.
You say he caught me, he choked me, he took advantage of me, is that right?
That's what I said.
Do you remember him beating you about the face? Are you sure enough he choked you? All the time you were fighting back, remember? You kicked and you hollered. Do you remember him beating you about the face? It's an easy enough question, Miss Mayella, so I'll ask it again. Do you remember him beating you about the face?
No, I don't remember if... yes, I do. Yes, he hit me.
Is the last sentence your answer?
Yes, he hit... Oh, I just don't remember. It all happened so fast.
Don't you cry, young woman.
Let her cry, Judge. We have all the time in the world.
Get me up here and mock me, will you? I'll answer any questions you got.
That's fine. There's just a few left. Will you identify the man who attacked you, Miss Mayo?
I will. That's him right yonder.
Tom, stand up. Let Miss Mayella take a good look at you. Is this the man, Miss Mayella?
Scout! Reverend! His left hand! He's crippled!
Got his arm caught in a cotton gin wound as a boy. Tore all his muscles loose.
Is this the man, Miss Mayella?
It most certainly is.
How could he have attacked you?
I don't know how! I said it all happened so fast!
Let's consider calmly.
Objection. He's browbeating the witness.
Sit down, Horace.
You testify that the defendant choked and beat you. You didn't say he sneaked up behind you and knocked you out cold. Do you wish to reconsider any of your testimony?
You want me to say something that didn't happen?
No. I want you to say something that did happen.
I already told you.
He hit you. He blackened your right eye with his right fist.
I ducked, and it glanced off. That's what happened. I ducked, and it glanced off.
You're a strong girl. Why didn't you run?
Tried to.
And you were screaming the whole time.
I positively was.
Why didn't the other children hear your screams? Where were they? Why wouldn't your screams make them come running? Or didn't you scream until you saw your father in that window? You didn't scream till then, did you? Did you scream at your father instead of Tom Robinson? Is that it? Who really beat you up, Tom Robinson or your father? Tell the truth, child. Didn't Bob Ewell beat you up?
I got something to say.
Would you like to tell us what happened?
I got something to say, then I ain't gonna say no more. That nigga yonder took advantage of me. If you fine, fancy gentlemen don't want to do nothing about it, then you're all yellow, stinking cowards. Stinking cowards, the lot of you. Your fancy airs don't come to nothing. Your Miami and Miss Baylor and don't come to nothing, Mr. Finch!
That's all. You can step down now. Sir, the state rests.
Shall we try to wind up this afternoon? What do you say, Atticus?
Yes, I think we can.
How many witnesses you got?
One.
Call them.
The defense calls Tom Robinson.
Sorry, sir.
That's okay, Tom.
Do you swear that the evidence you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I swear.
You're Tom Robinson. 25 years of age, married with 3 children, and you've been in trouble with the law once before. A 30-day sentence for disorderly conduct. What did that consist of?
Got in a fight with another man. Tried to cut me, but it wasn't much. Not enough to hurt.
You both were convicted.
I had to serve because I couldn't pay the fine. The other fellow paid his.
Were you acquainted with Miss Mayella Violet Yule?
Yes, sir. I had to pass by a place going to from the field.
Whose field?
Mr. Lingdee's.
You passed the Yule property to get to work. Was there any other way?
None that I know of.
Tom, would she ever speak to you?
Yes, sir. I passed by a place. One day she asked me to come inside the fence and bust up a shiffer rope.
When did she ask you to bust up the shiffer rope?
It was last spring. And after I busted up, she said, I reckon I have to pay you. And I said, no, ma'am, there ain't no charge. And I went home. That was over a year ago.
Did she ever ask you to come inside the fence again?
Yes, sir.
When?
Lots of times.
Under what circumstances? Why did you come inside the fence lots of times?
She asked me to come in. Every time I passed by yonder, she asked something for me to do, like chopping, killing, toting water for her.
Were you ever paid for your services?
No, sir. Not after the first time she offered me a nickel. Mr. Yule and the children didn't seem to help her, and I know she had no nickel to spare.
Where were the other children?
It was all over the place.
Tom, would she ever speak to you?
Yes, sir, she talked to me.
Did you, at any time, did you ever set foot on the Yule property? Did you ever set foot on the Yule property without an express invitation from one of them?
No, sir, I did not. I never do that.
Tom, tell us what happened to you on the evening of November 21st.
I was coming back from the field that evening, as usual. And when I passed by the old place, Miss Miella was sitting on the porch just like she said she was. It was real quiet-like, and I didn't know why. She asked me to come inside the fence and help her a minute. When I got inside the fence to find some killing to work on, I couldn't find her. And she told me to come inside the house because the door was off its hinges. So I walked up the steps, and she motioned me to come to the house. So I walked up, and I says, Miss Miella, you got a screwdriver? And she says she had. So I walk up to the door, and I says, Miss Miella, this door look all right. The hinges was all right. And then she shut the door. Then I noticed that there wasn't nobody on the place. And I says, Miss Miella, where the children at?
Go on, Tom.
I says, Miss Miella, where the children at? And she says she had sent them town. Took about a slap a year to save them 7 nickels, but she finally did. And she had sent them to town to go get some ice cream.
Keep going, Tom.
And I says, that's mighty smart of you to treat like that. But I don't think she understood what I was saying. I was saying that's mighty kind of him to treat him like that.
I understand. Go on.
Then I says, well, Miss Miella must be gone because I don't got nothing I could do for you. And she said, I did. And I said, what? And she said, she told me to get on top of the chair and grab that box off the shiffer rope.
The same one you busted up before?
No, sir. A different one. Most as tall as the room. So I got on the chair, and as I was reaching up for the box, she kind of hugged me around the legs. Got so scared, I jumped off the chair. Flipped over, and that was the only furniture disturbed in the room. I swear before God.
What happened after you tipped the chair over? Tom, you've sworn to tell the whole truth. What happened after that?
Answer the question, Tom.
After I jumped off the chair, she sort of jumped at me.
Jumped? Violently?
No, sir. She hugged me. She hugged me around the waist.
Tom, what did she do then?
She She started kissing me on the side of my face, and she said I never kissed a man before, and I might as well start off with a nigga. And I says, Miss Miella, let me out of here. Let me out of here. I didn't want harm or none. And I says, Miss Miella, let me out of here. Let me out of here. And by the time I says that, I heard Mr. Yule yelling down yonder from the window.
What did he do then?
I don't know. I ran.
Tom, what did he say?
Nothing fitting for these folks and children in here.
Tom, you must tell the jury what he said.
He says, damn whore, I'll kill you.
What happened after that?
I don't know, sir. I ran.
Tom, did you attack Mayelu?
I did not, sir.
Did you harm her in any way?
I did not, sir.
Did you resist her advances?
I thought I was ugly to her, sir. I don't want to be ugly to her.
Let's go back to Mr. Yule. Who was he talking to?
He was looking and talking to Miss Mayelu.
And then you ran?
Yes, sir.
Why did you run?
I was scared, sir.
Why were you scared?
Mr. Finch, if you was a nigga like me, you'd be scared too.
Thank you, Tom.
I want to say something to the whole lobby right now. Tom Robinson's worked for my husband for over 8 years, and we ain't never had a speck of trouble out of him. Not a speck.
That's enough, Mrs. Deeds. If you have something to say, you can say it under oath and at the proper time. You're all to disregard the remark from Miss Deeds. Okay, Mr. Gilmer.
You were given 30 days for disorderly conduct, Robinson?
Yes, sir.
Tell me, what did the other Negro look like when he got through with you?
He beat me, Mr. Gilmer.
But you were convicted, weren't you?
Yes, sir.
It was a misdemeanor, Judge, and it's in the record.
Witness will answer, though.
I had to serve 30 days.
You're pretty good at busting up Schiffer Open Kendall with one hand, aren't you, boy?
I reckon so, sir.
Say you're strong enough to choke the breath out of a woman?
I never did that, sir.
But you're strong enough.
I reckon so, sir.
Had your eye on her for a long time, hadn't you, boy?
I never looked at her like that.
Then you're mighty polite to do all that chopping and hauling for her, weren't you, boy?
I was just trying to help her.
That's mighty generous of you. Why were you so anxious to do all that woman's chores?
It seemed like nobody helped her none.
With Mr. Yule and 7 children on the place, boy?
Like I said, it didn't seem like they helped her none.
It's mighty polite of you. You did all that chopping and work for sheer goodness.
I was just trying to help us, sir.
You're a mighty good fella, it seems. Did all that for not one penny.
No, sir. I felt sorry for her. Seemed like she tried more than the rest of them.
You? Felt sorry for her? You felt sorry for her? He felt sorry for her. Mr. Yule, you went by the house as usual last November the 21st and... Mr. Robinson, you went by the house as usual last November the 21st, and she asked you to come in and bust up a shift rope.
No, sir.
Do you deny you went by the house?
No, sir.
She says she asked you to come in and bust up a shift rope. Is that right?
No, it ain't, sir.
You say she's lying, boy?
No, sir. I'm saying she's mistaken in her mind.
Tell me, boy, why did you run?
I was scared, sir.
You were scared? Why were you scared?
It wasn't safe for a nigga like me to be in a fix like that.
But you weren't in a fix. You testified you were resisting her advances. Were you scared she might hurt you? A big buck like you?
No, sir. I was scared I'd be in court just like I am.
Scared you'd have to face up to what you did?
No, I was scared I'd have to face up to what I didn't.
You being impudent to me, boy?
I'm not trying to be, sir.
No more questions.
You can step down now, Tom.
What's the matter with you?
I'm okay.
The heat got you? Ain't you feeling good?
Said I was okay.
Why'd you run out?
It's just, I'm beginning to realize some things. Like why Boo Radley stays shut up in his house. It's because he wants to stay inside.
That don't make any sense.
Maybe he figured out the way people can go out of their way to despise each other. Why must the game have to do Tom Robinson that way? Why do you have to talk so hateful?
Jill, that's his job.
But he didn't have to sneer and call him boy.
That's just Mr. Gilmer's way. They do all defendants that way. Most lawyers, I mean.
Mr. Finch doesn't?
He's not an example, Jill. He's the same in the courtroom as he is at home or on the street. Might be better if Atticus was a little more... If he was more
don't
like...
Don't you realize yet? Your father's not the run-of-the-mill man.
Most people...
What do you care about most people? Can't you
If you've got over your crying fit, I guess I can take you back in.
Wasn't a crying fit. Just didn't like the way Mr.
That's because you don't understand about the law. He speaks to the jury? How long's he been at it?
Just finished going over the evidence. And Scout, we're gonna win. I don't see how we can't.
With the court's permission.
Never saw him do that before.
Me either.
Gentlemen, this case is not a difficult one. It requires no minute sifting of complicated facts. It is as simple as black and white. The state has not produced one iota of evidence that the crime Tom Robinson is charged with ever took place. It has instead relied on the testimony of two witnesses. Testimonies who have not only been called into serious question on cross-examination, but have been flatly contradicted by the defendant. I have nothing but pity in my heart for the chief witness for the state. But my pity does not go so far as for her to put a man's life at stake. And this is what she has done. Done in an effort to get rid of her guilt. I say guilt because it was guilt that motivated her. She committed no crime, but she broke a rigid code of our society. A code so severe that whoever breaks it is hounded from our midst as unfit to live with. She is the victim of cruel poverty and ignorance. But she knew full well the enormity of her offense, and she persisted in it. She persisted, and her subsequent reaction is something that all children have done. She tried to put the evidence of her offense away, out of sight. What was the evidence that must be destroyed? Not some stolen toy to be hidden, but Tom Robinson. A human being, Tom Robinson, a daily reminder to her of what she did. And what did she do? She tempted a Negro. She did something that in our society is unspeakable. She's white, and she tempted a Negro. Not an old uncle, but a strong, young black man. No code mattered to her before she broke it, but it came crashing down on her afterwards. Her father saw what happened, and what did he do? There's circumstantial evidence that Mayella Yule was beaten savagely by someone leading almost exclusively with their left hand.
Damn you to...
And Mr. Yule no doubt sought out a warrant. No doubt signing it with his left hand. And now, Tom Robinson sits before you, swearing an oath with the only good hand he possesses. His right hand.
Lying!
Shut your mouth, sir. You'll be fine for contempt.
And now, a quiet, respectable Negro man who had the unmitigated temerity to feel sorry for a white woman is on trial for his life. He has had to put his word against his two white accusers. I need not remind you of their conduct here in court, their cynical confidence that you gentlemen would go along with the assumption The evil assumption that all Negroes lie and that all Negroes are basically immoral. An assumption that goes along with minds of their caliber. But you gentlemen know the truth. And the truth is some Negroes lie. And some Negro men are not to be trusted around women, white or black. And the same can be said about some white men. This is a truth that can be applied to the entire human race and no particular race. In this year of grace, 1935, we're beginning to hear more and more references to Thomas Jefferson's phrase, "All men are created equal." But we know all men are not created equal, in the sense that some men are smarter than others. Some men have more money. Some have more opportunity because they're born with it. Some ladies bake better cakes. Some people are born with gifted beyond the normal scope. But there's one way in which all men are created equal. There's one human institution that makes a pauper the equal to a Rockefeller, the stupid man the equal to an Einstein. That institution, ladies and gentlemen, is a court of law. In our courts, all men are created equal. I'm no idealist to believe so firmly in the integrity of our courts and jury system. That is no ideal to me. It is a working and living reality. But a court is only as sound as its jury. And a jury is only as sound as the men who make it up. I'm confident you gentlemen will review the evidence you've heard. Come to a decision and restore this defendant to his family. In the name of God, do your duty.
Did he say something else as he was walking back?
I think he said, "In the name of God, believe him." Look yonder.
Calpurnia, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Could I speak with Mr. Finch, please, sir? It hasn't gotten anything to do with the trial.
Of course.
What is it, Cal? Judge, she says my children are missing. Says they've been gone since noon. Could you? Jim, Scout, come down.
Is he mad?
We'll find out. We've won, haven't we, Atticus?
I have no idea. You've been here all afternoon. We'll go home with Cal and stay home.
Oh, please let us hear the verdict.
Have you done your reading yet for Mrs. DeBose?
Well, no, sir. Not today.
Tell you what. Do your reading for Mrs. DeBose. Eat your supper, and Cal can bring you back.
Sir!
They've heard it all up until now. They might as well hear the rest. Thank you, Cal.
I should skin every one of you alive. The very idea you children listening to all that? Mr. Jim, don't you know better than to take your little sister to that trial? As for you, Mr. Dim, you watch out your Aunt Rachel don't ship you back to Meridian first thing in the morning. You should be ashamed of yourselves.
Finch, better listen. I'm gonna kill you if it takes the rest of my life, you hear? I'm gonna kill you!
I saw that. I think I should speak to Heck Tate.
Let's not bother Heck.
Aren't you gonna say anything?
I wish Bob Ewell would not chew tobacco.
At least the children didn't see that. When they came back a few hours later, Calpurnia was still expressing her outrage.
Thought you was getting some kind of head on your shoulders, Mr. Jim. Ain't you got any sense at all?
Don't you want to see what happens?
You hush your mouth, sir. If Mr. Finch don't wear you out, I will.
How long have they been out?
Oh, hours. Mr. Finch and Mr. Gilmore did some more talking. And Judge Taylor charged a jury. Seemed like they were leaning a little to our side. Made Mr. Yule so mad, he stamped out.
The judge isn't supposed to lean either way. Besides, we don't need it, because we've already won.
Mr. Jim, I've never seen any jury decide in favor of a black man.
This case is different.
Wonder where's Atticus?
That Bob Yule looks mighty pleased about something.
Jim, ain't a long time.
Sure is, Scout. That could be a good sign.
I think something's happening.
Here we go.
This court will come to order.
Brother Tom.
Scout, look. The jury's coming in.
They're not looking at the defendant.
The defendant will rise.
What's it mean, Scout?
You're gonna see.
See what?
The jury finds the defendant guilty.
We lost! It's all lost!
How could they find him guilty?
It's not right you children should see such things. It's not right any children should see such things.
What happens now? What can we do?
If the evidence don't matter, I don't think there's anything we can do.
But Mr. Finch won't let him.
They can shout mean, hateful things at him and find Tom Robinson guilty. But no matter what any of them says, Atticus, he's...
Miss Jean, Louise, Scout, stand up for your father's passing.
Atticus, wait! Atticus, how could the jury do it?
I don't know how, but they did it. They've done it before, and they did it today. And they'll do it again. It seems like when they do it, only children weep. See you at home.
Seems to me the minute Mayella Yule opened her mouth and screamed, Tom Robinson was a dead man!
Jim!
I am absolutely surprised at you children. Did Atticus give you permission to go to court? What were you doing up in the colored balcony? Several people mentioned it. Wasn't it right close up there?
Hush, Stephanie.
Well, do you think it's wise for
children?
We've
made the town this way for them. They might as well learn to cope with it.
At least they don't have to wallow in it.
What happened today in court is as much a part of Maycomb as missionary teas.
Well, excuse me. Don't suppose they understood anyway. Sorry you had to see your daddy get beat.
When I get grown, I think I'll be a clown.
What, Dill?
Yes, sir, a clown. There ain't one thing in this world I can do about folks. So I'm gonna join the circus and laugh my head off.
You've got it backwards, Dill. Clowns are sad. It's people that laugh at them.
I'm gonna be a new kind of clown. I'm gonna stand in the middle of the ring and laugh. Laugh in their faces.
Don't pay attention to what she says about Atticus.
What do you mean?
I simply would like you to know that some men in this world are born to do our unpleasant jobs for us. And your father is one of them.
Oh, well...
Don't you oh well me, sir. You're just not old enough to appreciate what I said.
I always thought making folks were the best folks in the world.
We're the smartest folks in the world. We're so rarely called on to be Christians, but when we are, we've got men like Atticus to go for us.
But who feels that way besides you?
The handful of people in this town who believe that fair play isn't marked white only.
But who? Who did one thing to help Tom Robinson?
His friends, for one thing. And people like us. We exist too. People like Judge Taylor. People like Heck Tate. Start using your head, Jim. Did it ever occur to you that Judge Taylor naming Atticus to defend Tom Robinson was no accident? That Judge Taylor might have had his reasons?
That's right, Jim. Usually the court appoints a new lawyer, one who is just starting.
You're beginning to realize a little more to it than you thought. Whether Makeham knows it or not, we're paying your father the highest tribute we could pay a man. We trust him to do right.
Then why'd he get beat?
Miss Stephanie talks nonsense. He may not have gotten an acquittal, but he got something. As I was sitting in court waiting, I was thinking, Atticus won't win. He can't win, but he's the only man in these parts who can keep a jury out so long in a case like this. And I thought to myself, maybe we're taking a little step along the way. Well, I'm going to go to my kitchen now, and I'm going to bake a cake. And I would be pleased if you'd all join me later and have some of my cake.
Yes, Miss Martin.
Thank you.
Mr. Dill?
Yes, I'll come. Thank you.
Was taken to the Enfield prison farm about 70 miles away. Atticus thought that Tom had a good chance for a new trial, but Tom just couldn't hope anymore. His old employer made a job for Helen so she could support the children, but she had to pass the Yule place and they shouted and chucked things at her. She was terrified until Heck Tate came and made them desist. When Yule walked out of the courtroom, he expected to be the town hero, but nobody really believed him. All he got for his pain was, okay, you convicted the Negro, but now you get back to your dump. And Bob Yule's threats got worse, but Atticus just went about his business, working on Tom's appeal. Then suddenly, death was among us. First it was Mrs. DeVose. Jim was reading to her, and he saw something wasn't right. He called for his father, but it was too late. Her pain was over.
Her.
She had been given morphine for her pain, and she had become an addict. She wanted to break herself of it before she died. Your reading to her had become a distraction.
I never knew.
Her view on a lot of things were quite different from mine, but I wanted you to see.
Hello, Finch.
I wanted you to see what real courage was.
Got some good news, Finch.
Courage isn't a man with a knife in his hand, Jim. It's when you know you're licked before you begin. But you begin anyway. And you see it through no matter what. You rarely win, but sometimes you do. Mrs. DeBose won. All 98 pounds of her. She died clean as a mountain air.
Don't you want to hear, Finch?
Atticus.
What is it, Heck?
Got news.
Tell me.
I'll tell you. They shot that nigger.
Tom's dead.
They shot Tom!
He was during the exercise period. They say he just broke into a blind raven, charged at the fence, and started climbing over, right in front of them.
Oh, my. Cal, take the children inside.
They put 17 bullet holes in them.
I said for you to go inside. Didn't they try and stop him? Didn't they give him any warning?
They shouted at him, and they fired some shots in the air. They didn't start shooting at him till he's almost over the fence.
Why didn't he wait for the appeal?
I told him we had a chance, but I guess he was through with white man's chances.
Ain't just like a nigger to cut and run.
Is there anything more you'd like to say, Mr. Yule?
Yeah. I say there's one down, two to go. Now guess who's gonna be next?
I think I'd keep a shotgun loaded with 00.
He doesn't have a shotgun.
I can't believe Bob Yule would ever come after me. But if he did, I'd deal with him.
I expect you would.
Did they really shoot Tom 17 times?
There's talk, but I don't know. You better take care of yourself, Atticus.
Don't worry.
Atticus, I'm worried about you, and I think you should get a gun.
We've heard enough about guns. And I've told you twice to go inside.
That's how it's done.
I had a talk with Atticus, and he insisted things would settle down again. After a fashion, he said. And they did. The Maycomb ladies arranged a pageant in the school auditorium with taffy poles, apple bobbin, and children costumed to represent the county's agricultural products. A girl butterbean, a cow, a peanut. When I saw Jim leave with Scout, she was representing pork, with Jim holding onto her hawk. The clouds were already getting heavy when they left, and it looked like it might be storming before they got home. The pageant ended with everyone singing, "Maycomb County, we will aye be true to thee." Then Jim and Scout began their longest journey together. The moon had been in and out of the heavy rain clouds, but when they started home, it was black dark, and there was a stillness that comes before a thunderstorm. Somebody just walked over my grave.
Stop! I think I hear something.
You trying to scare me?
Come on. Someone's following us.
Jim, are you afraid?
I think we're almost home.
Reckon we ought to sing, Jim?
No, Scout, be real quiet.
I hear Jim!
He's coming! Run, Scout! Run! Run!
I tripped Jim! Help!
Where are you, Scout? Come on!
Can't see! I don't know where!
Get away, Scout! Run! Run! Ah!
Now you fail so...
Ah!
Jim! Help us! Someone help! Ah! Ah!
What is it? Who called? Oh, my. Cal, call Dr. Reynolds. Tell him it's urgent. Set him down on the... over... Where's Scout? Scout!
I'm here! I'm all right! The man's gone, but he did something to Jim. Atticus, is Jim dead?
He's unconscious. Looks like his arm's broken.
Scott, all right?
Yes.
Miss Eula May's getting Dr. Reynolds.
Jim's not dead, is he, Cal?
No. He's passed out from all the pain, but who would do this? Who would...
Call Heck Tate. Tell him somebody's been after my children.
After 10 forevers, they finally finished with Jim. Said it looked like someone tried to wring his arm off. Said it would be a while before he could play football again, but told Scout Jim positively was not dead.
Atticus.
Come in, Heck. Did you find anything? I can't conceive of anybody who would do this.
I'd rather speak with you out here.
What is it?
Bob Ewell's lying on the ground yonder with a kitchen knife stuck up under his ribs. He's dead, Mr. Finch.
Dead? Are you sure?
Good and dead. He won't hurt these children again.
But...
the mean as hell low-down skunk with enough liquor in him to make him brave enough to kill children.
I thought he got it out of him the day he spat at me. And if he hadn't, I thought I'd be the one he'd come after.
Now you know better. He broke Jim's arm, and then he grabbed you. Then what happened?
Someone came out to help. Someone.
Who was it?
There he is, Mr. Tate. He'll tell you his name. Hey, Boo.
His right name is Mr. Arthur. Boo is just a nickname. Miss Jean Louise, I'd like you to meet Mr. Arthur Radley. Maybe you'd like to take him inside. You can sit by Jim.
Like to come in, Mr. Boo?
Well, heck, the thing to do, Jim's a minor, of course. It'll come before county court.
What will, Mr. Finch?
Of course, it was clear-cut self-defense.
Mr. Finch, do you think Jim killed Bob Ewell?
They were struggling in the dark. He must have gotten a hold of Ewell's knife.
It wasn't Jim.
Then who could it have been?
I'll tell you. Bob Ewell fell on his knife. He killed himself.
That's kind of you. And I know you're saying that out of the good of your heart. But I won't have Jim grow up with a whisper about him. I won't hush up.
Hush up what? Jim didn't do it.
I won't have my children hear me say something different than I know what, than they know what to be true. If I did, I wouldn't have them anymore. I can't live one way in town and another way in my home.
Mr. Finch, I hate to fight you when you're like this. Now, you're under a stress no man should have to be put through. Maybe that's why you're not putting two and two together.
Then if it wasn't Jim...
Of course it wasn't. His arm was broken.
Then it'd have to be. Must have been...
No, put that thought out of your mind. I already told you what happened.
What are you saying, Heck?
I'm saying there's a black man dead for no reason, and the white man responsible for it is lying on the ground dead. So let the dead bury the dead this time, Mr. Finch.
But what about him?
It's not your decision, Mr. Finch. It's all mine. It's my responsibility and my decision. And there's not much you can do about it.
What are you gonna...
No. I never heard tell it's against the law for a citizen to do his utmost to prevent a crime from being committed. Which is exactly what Boo Radley did. Now maybe you'll tell me it's my duty to tell the town all about it and not to hush it up. Know what had happened then? All the ladies in Macomb, including my wife, would be knocking at his door, bringing him angel food cakes. To my way of thinking, dragging him with his shy ways into the limelight. Now that's a sin. I may not be much, Mr. Finch, but I'm still Sheriff of Macomb, and Bob Ewell fell on his knife. Good night, sir.
Scout?
Yes, Atticus?
Bob Ewell fell on his knife. Can you possibly understand?
Sir, it looks to me what Heck said was...
Miss Jean Louise?
Yes, Mr. Boo?
Will you take me home?
Mr. Arthur, bend your arm down. Like that, that's right, sir.
Arthur. Thank you for my children.
The moon had come out, the storm had passed, and I couldn't help but hope Miss Stephanie was watching from her upstairs window, seeing Arthur Radley escort Miss Jean Louise as any gentleman would do. None of us ever saw him again, but I saw something else. Neighbors bring food with death, flowers with sickness, and Boo was our neighbor. He gave two children a pair of slicked-up good-luck pennies, a stick of chewing gum, in their lives. Miss Jean Louise.
Didn't have to stay in Boo Radley's shoes, Noam. Just staying on his porch was enough.
You feel all right, girl?
I feel old. Jim and I still have to get grown, but there isn't much else left for us to learn, except possibly algebra.
I expect you'll handle it.
Jim awake yet?
He's asleep. Probably won't be awake till morning.
Atticus, what Hecate said about dragging Boo Radley into the limelight, Heck was right.
What do you mean?
Meaning sort of be like shooting a mockingbird, wouldn't it?
Let's go inside and sit by Jim.
All those ideas we had about Boo Radley. But Atticus, he's real nice.
Most people are, Scout. When you finally see them.
Thank you.